first act shows date is May 7th, 1901, before dawn. Yeah, just about. Sky's beginning to show some streaks of light east over there back on the mountain. Almost star always gets so powerful bright the minute before it has to go, doesn't it? Well, now I'll show you how our town lies. Up here is Maze. Cut across on the left over there, the railroad tracks. Across the tracks, even a coach town. You know, foreign families come here to work. A couple of other families in Catholic Church. Oh, a congregational church down there. Presbyterians across the street. Methodist and a Unitarian are down there. Baptist is down in the river by the park. Now, up here on Main Street, by the post office, the town hall, jails, and basement. A bride once made a speech from those steps there. Along Main Street's a row of stores, force blocks and hitching posts in front of them. First automobile's gonna come along about 5 years. Belong to our town's richest citizen, Banker Cartwright. Lives up in the hill up there in that big white house. Up there on Main Street also is Mr. Morgan's drugstore and the grocery store. Most everybody in our town manages to poke their heads in that one store about once a day. And here is Doc Gibbs' house. And right here is Doc Gibbs' back door. And here's Mrs. Gibbs' garden. Corn, peas, hot hocks, vegetable, a lot of bird. Back then, our paper wrote this corner Sentinel, came out twice a week. This is Editor Webb's house, and here is Mrs. Webb's garden. A lot like Mrs. Gibbs over there, only it's got a lot of sunflowers. And right here is a big butternut tree. Nice town, you know what I mean? Nobody very remarkable ever came out of it, so far as we know. Earliest dates in the cemetery up there, say 1660, 1670. They're Grovers, Cartwrights, Gibbses, Hearses. Same names around here now. Well, as I said, it's early morning. Only lights on in town are over in Polish town, where our mother's just had twins. And the Joe Crowell house, where Joe Jr. is about to deliver the morning paper. Oh, and in the train depot where Shorty Hopkins is getting ready to flag 5:45. Really? There she is. Well, as I said, it's early morning. There's Doc Gibbs coming out of Main Street now. Coming back from that baby's. Oh, and here's Mrs. Gibbs' wife coming out to make breakfast. Doc Gibbs died in 1930. A new hospital's named after him. Mrs. Gibbs, she died before, a long time ago, in fact. She was out visiting her daughter, Rebecca, who married an insurance man in Canton, Ohio, and died there in pneumonia. She's up there in the cemetery there now, up there with a whole mess of Gibbses and Hearses. She was Julia Hearsey before she married Doc Gibbs over at the Congregational Church. In our town, we like to know the facts about everybody. Oh, and that's Doc Gibbs. He's coming back from that baby case now. Oh, and there's Joe Crowell delivering the morning paper. Oh, and Mrs. Webb coming out to make breakfast.
Morning, Doc.
Morning, Joe.
You want your paper now?
Sure, I'll take it.
Anybody been sick, Doc?
A pair of twins over in Polish town. Joe, I hear your teacher, Miss Foster's getting married.
Yes, sir. To fill over the concourse.
I declare. How do you boys feel about that?
Well, it ain't none of my business, but I feel if a person starts out to be a teacher, well, she ought to stay one.
How's your knee, Joe?
Oh, it's fine, Doc. It doesn't bother me much. Just like you said, it always tells me when it's going to rain.
What's telling you today? Is it going to rain?
No, sir.
You sure?
Oh, yes, sir.
You ever made a mistake?
No, sir.
I want to tell you something about that boy, Joe, then. Awful bright Joe was, graduated head of his class. So he got a scholarship to Boston Technical. Well, MIT, that is. Well, he graduated head of his class there, too. It was all written up in the Boston papers at the time. Gonna be a great engineer, Joe was. But the war broke out and he died in France. Yes, sir, all that education What business he had picking a fight with the Germans, we can't figure out to this day, but it all seemed perfectly clear to us at the time.
Come on, Bessie. What's the matter with you?
Well, that's how we use them, delivering the milk.
Morning, Doc.
Morning, Doc.
Somebody been sick?
Her twins are with Miss Garcilaski.
Twins, eh? This town's getting bigger all the time.
Gonna rain now?
Oh, no, no. Fine day. It'll burn through. Whoa, Bessie.
Good morning, Bessie. How old is she out?
Going on 17. Still mixed up off the router since the Lockhart stopped taking their quart of milk every day. Wants to give it to him just the same. Keeps scolding me the whole trip. Down the street now.
Is he? Seems like you're late today.
Yeah, something went wrong with the separator. Still don't know what it was. Doc?
Howard?
Children! Children! Time to get up!
Come on, Bessie.
George! Rebecca! You'll be late for school! Everything all right, Frank?
Yes, I declare. Easy as kittens. Miss Garcilaski's coming at 11. I guess no one's about to. We're sure we'll be able to talk to me.
Awful, Franken. You don't get more than 3 hours of sleep. I declare, I don't know what's going to become of you. I do wish you could get away someplace and take a rest. I think it would do you some good.
Children! Wally! Ellie! You'll be late for school!
I declare, you've got to speak to George. He's no help to me at all. I can't even get him to cut me some wood.
Is he sassy to you?
No, he just whines. All he thinks about is that baseball brand. George!
George, look sharp.
Yes, Pa.
Wally, you wash yourself good, or I'll come up there and do it myself.
Don't you hear your mother calling you?
Here, you don't belong to me. Where'd you come from?
Don't be afraid. I won't hurt you. Oh, hello, Myrtle. How's your cold?
Well, I still get that tickling in my throat. Told Charles I didn't know I'd go to choir practice tonight.
Have you tried singing over your voice?
Yes, but I can't do that and stay on key. While I'm resting, I thought I'd string some beans. I decided to put up 40 chords even if it killed me. Children say they hate them, but I noticed they were able to get them down all winter.
Well, Myrtle, I've got to tell you something. Something I don't tell somebody, I'll surely burst.
Why, Julia Gibbs!
Myrtle, did one of those secondhand men from Boston went by to see you last Friday?
No.
Well, one caught on me. First, I thought it was a patient waiting to see the doctor. Then he warned his way to my car. And Myrtle Webb offered me $350 for Grandmother Wentworth's highway. As I'm sitting here.
Why, Julia Gibbs!
He did. That old thing. Why, I was so big and bulky, I didn't know what I was going to do with it. Almost gave it to Cousin Hester Wilcox.
Well, you're going to take it, aren't you?
I don't know.
You don't know? $350? What's come over you?
Well, if I could get the doctor to take it, go away somewhere on vacation. I'd settle like that. No, Charlie's been a dream of mine to see Paris, France. Oh, I don't know, so silly, I suppose. But I keep promising myself that I'd get the chance.
Well, what's Doc say about that?
Well, I did read about the British girl. Told him if I ever got the legacy, that's how I put it, that I'd make him take me.
And what did he say?
Oh, you know how he is. Haven't heard a serious word out of him since I've known him. No, he says. Might make him discontent with Grover's Corners, he says. Every 2 years we go to the Civil War battlefield, and that's enough treat for anyone, he says.
Well, Mr. Webb just admires the way Doc Gibbs knows everything about the Civil War. Mr. Webb has a good mind to switch over from Napoleon. Only Doc Gibbs, being one of the foremost authorities, only makes him despair.
The doctor's never so happy as when he's in Antietam or Gettysburg. You know, remember the time we spent going from bush to bush, pacing it all up? Like we were going to buy it.
Well, if that second-hand man's really serious, Julia, you take it. You just keep dropping hints and you'll get to see things. That's the way I got to see the Atlantic Ocean, you know.
Oh, I'm sorry I mentioned it. But it seems to me that once in your life, got a good old place where they don't speak English and don't even want to.
Thank you very much, ladies. And now we'll have to interrupt here. You see, we want a little more information about it. Kind of a scientific account, you might say. So I've asked Professor Willard of our state university to come and sketch in a few details about past history here. Professor Willard? May I introduce Professor Willard of our state university? Just a few brief notes, thank you, Professor. Unfortunately, our time here is limited.
Grover's Corners, let me see. Grover's Corners lies on the old piercing granite of the Appalachian Range. I may say it's some of the oldest land in the world. I'm very proud of that here. But there have been some more recent outcroppings. For instance, a shelf of Devonian basalt causes vestiges of Mesozoic shale. But that's all comparatively new to 300 million years old. Shall I resume Professor Gruber's notes on the meteorological situation, precipitation, etc.?
Afraid we won't have time for that, Professor. Perhaps you'd like to give a few details about the history of man.
Oh, Pramata Patata! Early American Indians, Carnahatchee tribes, new evidence before the 10th century. Oh, early brachiocephalic blue-eyed stock since the 12th century, some Slav and Mediterranean.
Any population, Professor?
2,642. Oh, silly me! 2,642 for the moment. The postal district
and socialist. The rest indifferent. While religiously, we are 82% Protestant, 12% Catholic, and the rest darn different.
Have you any comments about our town?
It's a very ordinary town, if you ask me. A little bare behavior, most. And probably a little duller, too. But our young folk do seem to like it well enough. In fact, 90% of them graduated from high school and still don't graduate with it.
Now, is there anybody in the audience who would like to ask Editor Webb any questions about our town?
Why, yes. Is there much drinking in Grover's Corners?
Well, ma'am, I wouldn't know what you'd call much. But Saturday nights, the farmhands like to be down at the Elder Green stable and holler some. And we do have one or two town drunks. But they seem to remorse every time the Grangelos come to town. Well, ma'am, I say liquor and regular thing in the home, except the medicine chest. But good thing for takeout, you know. Always was.
Is there any other questions?
Is there no one in
here? Oh, come forward, will you, where we can all hear you. Now, what was it you wanted to ask?
I said, is there no one in town aware of social injustice and industrial inequality?
Oh, yes, something terrible. Seems like all they do is talk about who's rich and who's poor.
Well, then, why don't they do something about it?
Well, ma'am, I don't know. I guess we're all hunting for the way, like everybody else. But it ain't easy to find. The diligent and sensible can swim to the top, while the lazy and quarrelsome seem to the bottom. So in the meantime, we do all we can to take care of those who can't take care of themselves. And those who can, well, you leave alone. Are there any other questions?
Mr. Webb!
Yes, ma'am?
Mr. Webb, is there any level of culture or beauty in Grover's Corners?
Well, ma'am, there ain't much. Not in the sense you mean. Come to think of it, we do have some girls that play the piano at the high school commencement. But they ain't too happy about it. Well, ma'am, there isn't. There isn't much more. But maybe this is a place sometimes that we've got a lot of pleasures of the kind. Like, we like watching the sun come up over the mountains in the morning. And we all know a good deal about the birds. We pay a lot of attention to them. And we like watching the change in the seasons. Yes, ma'am, you're right. Everybody knows about those things. Robinson Crusoe, the Bible, Handel's Largo. We all know that. And Whistler's mother. But that's about as far as we know.
Thank you, Mr. Webb. Now we'll get back to the town. It's 2 o'clock. All 2,642 lunches have been had, and the dishes have been washed. Only a few horses on Main Street, dozing at the hitching posts. Children have gone back to school. There's a buzzing and humming from the school buildings. There's an early afternoon call about the town. You remember what it was like. Dr. Gibbs is in his office tapping people, making them say ah. Mr. Webb over there is cutting his lawn. One man in 10 thinks it's a privilege to push his own lawn.
You get stuck, George. You just whistle to me and I'll give you some hints.
Here's naturally bred, I guess.
Well, I figure it's just the way a person's born.
Oh, well, I want to be a farmer on Michael Lewis' farm. He says whenever I'm ready, I can come start working. And then just gradually hand it.
You mean the house and everything?
Yeah. Well, I better be getting out to the baseball field. Thanks for talking, Emily. Good afternoon, Mrs. Webb.
Good afternoon, George.
So long, Emily.
He's growing up.
How old is George now?
I don't know.
Well, he must be almost 16.
Mama, I made a speech in class today and I was very good.
Well, you must recite it to your father at supper. What was it about?
Oh, the Louisiana Purchase. It was like silk on spool. I'm gonna make speeches all my life. Mama, are these big enough?
Oh, well, try to get them a little bigger if you can, dear.
Mama, will you answer me a question serious?
Seriously, dear, not serious.
Seriously, will you?
Of course I will.
Mama, am I the bully?
Yes, of course. Both my children got good features. I'd be ashamed if they hadn't.
Well, that's not what I meant. I mean, am I pretty?
Emily, I already told you. You have a nice, pretty young face. Now, I've never heard such foolish.
Well, you never tell us the truth about anything.
I am telling you the truth.
Mama, were you pretty?
Yes, I was, if I do say it. I was the prettiest girl in town next to Baby Cartwright.
Mama, you've got to say something. Am I pretty enough to get people interested in me?
Emily, stop this. You make me tired. You're pretty enough for all normal purposes. Now, bring that bowl.
Mama, you're no help at all.
Now, I think this is a good time to tell you that the Cartwright interests have begun building a new bank in Grover's Corners. Had to go to Vermont for the marble, sorry to say. And they've asked a friend of mine what he thinks they should put in the cornerstone for people 1,000 years from now to dig up. Well, we put in a copy of the New York Times, copy of Grover's Corner Central. We're awfully interested in that sort of thing because some scientific fellows have found a way of painting all this reading matter with a kind of glue. Well, a silicate glue. It'll make it keep 1,000, 2,000 years. And we put a copy of Bible, William Shakespeare's play, Constitution of the United States. What do you think, folks? What do you think? You know, Babylon once had 2 million people, and all we know about them is the names of the kings and some sales of some slaves from some wheat contracts. Yes, all those people have come home for dinner, fathers have come home for work, and smoke would go up the chimney just like here. And even in ancient Greece and Rome, all we know about the real life of the people is what we can piece together out of some joking poems and comedies they wrote for the theater. So, I've decided to have a copy of this play put in the cornerstone for people 1,000 years from now to dig up. So people then will know a little bit more about us other than the Treaty of Versailles and the Lindbergh flight. So, people 1,000 years from now, this is the way we were. This is the way we were in the provinces north of New York in the 20th century.
What?
gossiping about tonight?
Believe me, Frank, they have plenty to gossip about.
Simon Stimson, far gone, was he?
Worst I've ever seen him. How will that end, Frank?
I guess I know more about Simon Stimson's troubles than anyone else in this town. Some people weren't meant for small town life. I don't know how that led, but I know there's nothing we can do but just to leave it alone. Come on, give me.
No, not yet. Frank, I'm worried about you.
What are you worried about?
I think it's my duty to make sure you get a rest. And if I ever get that legacy, Frank, I'm going to insist on it.
Now, Julie, there's no sense in starting this again.
But Frank, you're just being unreasonable.
Come on, Julia. Next thing you know, you'll pitch cold. I gave George a piece of my mind tonight. You'll have your wood cut for a while, anyway. No, stop.
Mine, there's only so many things to think about. Frank, Mrs. Fairchild locks her doors at night. All the people in that part of town do.
They're all getting acidified. That's the trouble with them. If you haven't anything fit to burgle, and everyone knows.
Smoke.
Yeah, go find it if you can. Please.
3 years gone by. Yes, the sun's come up over 1,000 times. Some of those winters have cracked the mountains a little bit. The rain has brought down some of the dirt. Oh, some babies that weren't even born before began speaking in regular sentences. Oh, some older people who thought they were not young and spry noticed they can't bound up a flight of stairs like they used to without their heart fluttering a little bit. Oh, and nature's been pushing and contriving in other ways, too. A number of young people fell in love about Mary. Yes, mountains got bit away a few fractions of an inch. Millions of gallons of water gone by the mill. Here and there, a new home was set up under a roof. Almost everybody gets married. In our town, there are hardly any exceptions. Most everybody climbs into their graves married. The first act was called Daily Life. This one's called Love and Marriage. So it's 3 years later. It's 1904, just after high school commencement. That's when most of our young people jump up and decide to get married. Seems like after they've passed their last examinations in solid geometry and Cicero's orations, they feel themselves fit to get married. Well, it's early morning again, only this time it's been raining. It's been thundering and pouring. Mrs. Webb, it's gotten here. Mrs. Webb, drenched. And all them bean poles and pea vines drenched. Up there on Main Street yesterday, the rain looked like curtains being blown long. And here comes Mrs. Gibbs, Webb, coming out to make breakfast just like this were any ordinary day. Now, I don't have to tell the ladies in the audience, but these women, these ladies they see before them, cooked and clean, 3 meals a day, one for 20 years and the other for 40 years. Never had a nervous breakdown. They raised 2 children apiece, washed, never felt themselves hard used either. It's like what one of their Middle Western poets used to say. You gotta love life to have life, and you gotta have life to love life. It's what they call a vicious circle.
Come on, Bessie. Oh, and there's Howard Newsome and Bessie delivering the milk.
Morning, Howie.
Morning, Doc.
How do you know about? Nothing much except to lose about the best baseball pitcher Grover's Corners ever had.
every once in a while looks in the mirror and says, I do, but it don't sound convincing to me.
I declare, Frank, I don't know how they'll get along. He seemed to his clothes. He made sure his feet are dry and he's got warm things to wear. They're too young, Frank. Emily won't think of such things. And he'll catch his death of cold within a week.
I remember my wedding morning to him.
Now don't start that.
I must have been the scariest young man in the state of New Hampshire. Thought I made a mistake for sure. When I saw you coming down the aisle, I thought you were the most beautiful girl I'd ever seen in my life. And the trouble was, I'd never seen you before. There I was, wearing a total stranger.
Well, how do you think I felt, Frank? Wedding a perfectly awful thing. Farces, that's what they are. I've made you something.
Why, Julie Ersey, French toast.
It ain't hard to make, but I had to do something.
Shopping time, I think of George setting up to be a family man. Great gaming thing. I tell you, Julia, there's nothing more frightening in the world than a son. The relationship between a father and a son is the damnedest, awkwardest.
Well, relationship between a mother and daughter don't picnic, let me tell you.
They'll have troubles, I imagine, but that's none of our business. Everyone's got the right to their own troubles.
Aye. People are meant to live two by two in this world. They naturally do. Did you hear Rebecca stirring around upstairs this morning?
Well, on the day of the year, she ain't minding everyone else's business up there. She's hiding in the room. You get the feeling she's crying.
Lord sakes, this has got to stop. Rebecca! Rebecca, come and get your breakfast!
Good morning, everybody. 4 more hours to live.
George Gibbs, where do you think you're going?
I'm just stepping across the grass to see my girl.
Put on your overshoes. It's raining torrents out.
Well, it's just a step.
You'll catch a death of cold and cough all through the service.
George, do as your mother tells you.
Tomorrow on, you can kill yourself in all weathers for as far as I'm concerned. But while you live in my house, you'll live wisely, thank you. Perhaps this is web as it used to call us at 6 in the morning.
Well, I'll be back in a minute.
Wait, here, take a cup of coffee.
Good morning, Mother Webb.
George, you frighten me. Now listen, George, you can stand here a minute out of the rain, but you must understand I cannot ask you in.
Well, why not?
George Gibbs, you know well as I do, the groom is not supposed to see his bride on his wedding day before he sees her in church.
Well, that's just a superstition. Good morning, Mr. Webb.
Good morning, Charles.
Mr. Webb, you don't believe in a superstition like that, do you?
Well, there's a lot of common sense in superstition, George.
Millions have followed it, George, and don't you be the first to fly in the face of custom.
How's Emily?
I don't know. Haven't heard a peep out of her all morning.
Emily's asleep?
Well, no, we're up packing and sewing half the night. Listen, George, I'll tell you what I'll do. You sit here and have a cup of coffee with Mr. Witt. I'll go up and see that she doesn't come down and surprise you. There's some bacon there, too, but be quick about it.
Well, George, how are you today?
I'm fine. Mr. Webb, what common sense could there be in a superstition like that?
Well, George, on the wedding day, a girl's head's full of, clothes, one thing or another. Don't you think that's probably it?
Well, yeah. I never thought of that.
A girl's apt to be mighty nervous on her wedding morning, George.
Gosh, I wish a person could get married with all that, without all that marching up and down.
Every man that's ever lived is called that way, George. But it hasn't been any use. It's the women folk who built up the weddings. For a while now, the women have had it all their own, my boy. Yes, the man looks pretty small. All those good women standing shoulder to shoulder, making trips in a mighty public way.
Well, you believe in it, Mr. Webb?
Yes. Well, yes. Now, don't get me wrong, George. Marriage is a wonderful thing. A wonderful thing. Now, don't you forget that.
Yes, sir. Mr. Webb, how old were you when you got married?
Well, you see, George, I've been away to college. I'd taken some time to get settled down. But Ms. Webb, she wasn't much older than what Emily.
were you going to say, Mr. Webb?
I don't know. Was I going to say something? Ah, yes. I was remembering the other night some of the advice my father gave me on my wedding. Charles, he said, start right out showing who's the boss. Best thing to do is to give an order about something, even if it don't make sense. And then he said, if anything about her irritates you, her conversation, or anything, just get right up in the house. That will show her. And then he said, never, ever let your wife know about how much money you have.
Never. Wife didn't exactly...
So I took the opposite of his advice, and I've been happy ever since. Yeah. So let that be a lesson to you, my wife. Don't ask advice on personal matters. Charles, are you going to raise chickens on your farm?
Well...
Chickens. Are you going to raise chickens on your farm?
Chickens? Oh, Uncle Luke's never been in for chickens much, but I've been figuring on reading up.
George, the other day, a book came to my office on the Bible system of raising chickens. I wish you'd read it. I'm thinking about beginning in a small way myself, in the backyard. I'm going to put an incubator in the cellar.
Charles Webb, were you talking about that incubator again? I thought you would be talking about things worthwhile.
Well, Merle, if you want to give the boys some good advice, I'll just go upstairs.
George, Emily has to come down and eat the breakfast. She sends her love, but she doesn't want to lay her eyes on me. Now, goodbye.
See you later.
Well, Merle, I guess you never heard of that older superstition.
What are you talking about, Charles?
Since caveman, no bridegroom should see his father-in-law on the day of the wedding or anywhere near. Now, remember that, please.
Thank you very much, Mr. and Mrs. Webb. But now I have to interrupt you again. You see, we want to know how all this started, this wedding, this plan to spend a lifetime together. Well, I'm awfully interested in how big things like that get started. You know what I mean? You're 20, 21, make some decisions, and then whoosh. You're 70, you've been alive for 50 years, and that black-haired lady sitting across the table is eating over 50,000 meals. How do such things begin? Well, George and Emily are going to show you now. The conversation they first had with, they knew well. As the saying goes, they were meant for one another. But first, I want you to remember what it was like when you were very young, particularly the days when you were first in love, when you were like a person sleepwalking, only you didn't quite see the street you were walking, and you didn't quite hear everything that was being said. We all remember that, please. Well, they'll be coming out of high school around 3 o'clock. And George has just been elected senior class president. And as this is June, he'll be serving all next year. Oh, and Emily's been elected secretary of the treasury. Here they are on Main Street now.
I can't, Lois. I've got to go home and tell my mother. Ernestine, can you come over tonight and do Latin? I'll tell your mother you have to. Goodbye. Goodbye, Helen. Goodbye, Fred.
Emily? Can I carry your books home for you?
Thank you. Is it far?
Excuse me 1 minute, Emily, will you? Say, boss, I'm a little late to start practice. Why don't you give her a few moments?
Goodbye, Lizzie.
Oh, goodbye. I'm awful glad you're elected too, Emily.
Thank you.
Emily, why are you mad at me?
I'm not mad at you.
Well, you've been treating me so funny lately.
Since you asked me, I might as well tell you. George, goodbye, Mrs. Conkren.
Oh, goodbye, Mrs. Conkren. What is it?
George, I don't like the whole change that's come over you in the last year. Now, I'm sorry if that hurts your feelings, but I've just got to tell the truth and shame the devil.
Change? What do you mean?
Well, up to a year ago, I used to like you a lot, and I used to watch you while you did everything. Because we've been friends for so long. Then you began spending all your time at baseball. You never stopped to talk, not even to your own family you didn't, George. And it's a fact, ever since you've been elected captain, you've gotten awful stuck up and conceited, and all the girls say so. And it hurts me to hear him say it, but I gotta agree with him a little, because it's true.
Well, gosh, Emily, never thought that such a thing was happening. I guess it's hard for a fellow not to have some faults creep into his character.
Well, I always expect a man to be perfect, and I think he should be.
I don't think it's possible to be perfect, Emily.
Well, my father is, as far as I can
Men aren't naturally good, but girls are.
Well, might as well know right now that I'm not perfect. Not as easy for a girl to be as perfect as a man, because, well, because we girls are more nervous.
Emily, would you like a soda or something before you go home? Too, well, I think that's just as important as college is, and even more so.
Well, I think think that's very important, too.
Emily, if I do improve and make a big change, would you be, could you be?
I am now, George. Always have been.
So I guess this is a pretty important talk with you.
Yes.
Excuse me 1 minute, Emily, and I'll walk you home. Mr. Morgan?
Yes, George.
I'm going to have to go home and get the money to pay for this. Mr. Morgan. I have reasons, Mr. Morgan. Here, take my gold watch until I come back.
Oh, that's all right, George. You keep your watch. I'll trust you.
I'll be back in 5 minutes.
I'll trust you 10 years, John Gibbs. Not a day over. Got all of your shock, Emily?
Thank you, Mr. Morgan. It was nothing.
Ready, Emily.
Well, now we get on with the wedding. You know, there are an awful lot of things to be said about a wedding. Awful lot of thoughts that go on during a wedding. Naturally, we can't get them all in one wedding, especially one in Rose Corners, where weddings are mighty short and plain. In this play, I take the part of the minister. That gives me the right to say a few things more. For a while now, this play gets pretty serious. Because some churches say that marriage is a sacrament. Now, I don't know quite what that means, but I can guess. It's like what Mrs. Gibbs said a minute ago. People are supposed to live two by two. Well, this is a good way. The people in it are young, they're from a good state, and they chose right. The real hero of this scene isn't even on stage at all. We all know who that is. It's like what one of them European fellas said. Every time a child is born into this earth, it's nature's attempt to make it a perfect human being. Well, we've all seen nature pushing and contriving for some time now. And we all know she's interested in quality. But I think she's interested in quality, too. Maybe she's trying to make another good governess for New Hampshire. Well, that's what Emily knows. Oh, and don't forget the other witnesses to this wedding. The ancestors. Millions of them. Most of them set out to live two by two also. Millions of them. Well, that's my sermon. It wasn't very long.
Thank you.
lot of this.
No, Ma, listen to me.
No.
George,
you're
mad now. Ma, for the last time I ask you, all I want to do is be a fella.
George, anyone should hear you. Why I'm ashamed of you.
What? Where's Emily?
Oh, George, you gave me such a turn.
Yeah. Ma, cheer up. I'm getting married. And why you say Thursday nights? Emily and I are coming over to dinner. Agreed, Thursday night. You'll see. Why you go funny? What are you crying for? Come on, we gotta get ready for this.
Locking their doors at night now. Haven't had any burglars, but we've all heard about it. You'd be surprised, though. On the whole, things don't change very much around here. This is certainly an important part of Grover's Corners. It's on a hilltop, a windy hilltop. Lots of sky, lots of clouds, often lots of sun, moon and stars. You come up here on a fine afternoon and you can see range on range of hills. Awful blue they are right there by Lake Sunapee and Lake Winnipesaukee. And if you go way up, you can see the White Mountains of Mount Washington up where Conway, North Conway is. And of course our favorite mountain, Mount Monadnock here. And all around it lie these little towns, Jaffrey, North Jaffrey, Peterborough, Dublin. There, way down, quite a ways, is Grover's Corners. Yes, beautiful spot up here. Mountain laurel lilacs. I often wonder why people would like to get buried in Brooklyn and Woodlawn when they might as well pass the same time up here. Over there are the old stones, 1616 and 1670. Strong-minded people come a long ways to be independent. Some people walk around there, laugh at the funny names on the tombstones. Well, that don't do no harm. Oh, and genealogists come up from Boston to look up people's ancestors, get paid by city folks who want to know their daughters of the American Revolution and the Mayflower. Well, that don't do no harm either. And over there, the Civil War veterans, iron flags on their graves. New Hampshire boys have a notion the Union ought to be kept together, even though they'd never seen more than 50 miles of it themselves. All they knew was the name, friends. United States of America. The United States of America. And they, when they died for it. Well, here's the new part of the cemetery. There's your friend, Mrs. Gibbs. Oh, and Simon Stimson, the organist of the Congregational Church. Oh, and Mrs. Soames, who enjoyed the wedding so much, remember her? Oh, and of course, a lot of others. Oh, there's Editor Webb's boy, Wallace, whose appendix burst on a camping trip to Cross the Notch. Yes, an awful lot of sorrow, so quiet it down here. People just wild with grief have brought their relatives up to this spot. Sunny days, rainy days, end times. You all know how it is. Awful lot of thoughts come up to this spot, but there's no post office. Now there's some things we all know, but we don't take them out and look at them very often. We all know in our bones that something is eternal. It ain't houses. It ain't names. It ain't the earth. It ain't even the stars. We all know that something is eternal. I mean, that something has to do with human beings. All the greatest people that ever lived have been trying to tell us that for 5,000 years, but yet you'd be surprised how often they go like that. And we all know deep down inside that something is eternal about every human being. You know, the dead don't stay interested when we live very long. Gradually they let go hold of the earth. And the ambitions they had, the pleasures they had, things they suffered, the people they loved. They get weaned away. That's the way I like to put it. Weaned away. They stay here for a while the earth part of them burns out, burns away. All that time, they slowly get indifferent to what's going on in those forms. Some of the things they might say maybe are going to hurt some of their feelings. That's the way it is. Enemy and enemy. Husband and wife, mother and daughter. Money and miser. All those terribly important things kind of grow pale around here. They're waiting. They're waiting for something they feel is coming, something important. Great. And what's left when they're waiting and everything kind of burns out? What's left when your identity's gone? And your memory, Mrs. Smith? begins and start opening up whole new field section by Adam and B. Oh, excuse me, now I see their color.
Who is it, Julia? My daughter-in-law, Emily Webb. Well, I declare, the road up here must have been awfully muddy. What did she die of, Julia? In childbirth. I've forgotten all about that. My, wasn't life awful? And wonderful.
Wonderful, was it?
Now, Simon, remember. I remember Emily's wedding. Wasn't it a lovely wedding? And I remember her reading a classic poem at graduation as a Emily was one of the brightest girls ever graduated from high school. I've heard Principal Wilkins say so time after time. I called on them at their new farm just before I died. Perfectly beautiful farm.
Lived on the same road we lived on.
Yep, right to my farm.
I always liked that hymn. I was hoping they'd sing a hymn.
Hello.
Hello, Emily.
Hello, Miss Gibbs. Hello, Mother Gibbs.
Emily.
Hello.
Baby.
Yes, dear. Just rest yourself and be patient. 5,000 years. Remember, that was my favorite. I wish I'd been here a long time. Like being new here.
Here, just wait and be patient.
How do you do, Mr. Stinson?
How do you do, Emily?
Oh, Mother Gibbs, George and I have made that farm into just the best place you ever saw. We thought of you all the time, and we wanted to show you the great new barn and the new cement drinking fountain for the stock. We bought that out of the money.
Did I?
Don't you remember, Mother Gibbs, the legacy you left us? Why, it was over $350.
Yes, Emily.
Well, there's a patented device on this drinking fountain, so it never overflows, Mother Gibbs, and it never sinks below a certain mark they have there. It's fine. It's the same to George without me, but it is a nice farm. But the kids, black people don't understand, do they?
No, dear, not very much.
They're sort of shut up in little boxes, aren't they? Yeah. Here, as though I knew it last 1,000 years ago. Anyway, my boy is spending the day at Mrs. Carter's. Mrs. Carter, my boy is spending the day at your house.
Is he?
Yes, he loves it there. My mother gives me a Ford, too. Never gives any trouble. I don't drive, though. Well, the kids went to the school and go away. Of being one of them, how...
Shh. You're just waiting to be patient.
I know. Look. They're going. Flowers to you. Looks just like George, doesn't it? Never realized before, troubled and how in the dark my persons are. Look at him. I loved him so. From morning till night, that's all they are is trouble.
A little cooler than it was.
I am. The rain's pulled it off a little.
Those northeast winds always do the same thing, don't they? Tain't rain, it's a 3-day blow.
Mother Gibbs, one can go back there again, into living. I feel it. I know it, but just then for a moment I was sitting here and I was thinking about the farm. Just for a moment I was there. My baby was on my lap, as plain as day.
But of course you can, dear.
I can go back and live there again. Why not?
Some of them tried. They soon come back here.
But it's true, isn't it?
Don't do it, Emily. Emily, don't. It's not what you think it would be.
Oh, but I won't live over a sad day. I choose a happy day. I choose the day I first knew I loved George.
No. If you need to choose a day, choose an unimportant day. The least important. important day of your life. It'll be enough, important enough to you.
And it can't be since I was married, since the baby was born. Well, I can choose a birthday at least, can't I?
Yes, but while you're there, you not only live it, but you watch yourself live it. And you see what they down there never know. You see the future. You know what's going to happen afterwards.
There's other reasons too, Alan. The thing I must know for myself, I'll choose a happy day anyway. I choose my 12th birthday.
All right. It's February 14th, 1899. Is there any particular time of day you would like?
We want the whole day.
All right, we'll begin at dawn. You remember it had been snowing, but it cleared up the night before. May begin again in a moment. The sun's coming up.
There's Main Street. There's Mr. Morgan's drugstore before I changed it. And the livery stable.
Yes, this is 14 years ago. It's 1899.
The town I knew was a little girl. Here's the white picket fence that used to be around our house. Forgotten that. Forgotten so. Are they inside?
Yes, your mother will be coming down in a moment to make breakfast.
Does she?
And you remember your father had been away on a trip. He was coming back on the early morning train. Yes, he had been away to make a speech at his college.
There's Howie Newsome. And there's our policeman. But he's dead. He died.
Good morning, Bill.
Morning, Howie.
You're up early.
Yeah, I went to Sailor Polish party down south. Yeah, I dropped right out of the snow, I guess. But the other man running show.
There's Joe Crowell.
Morning, Mr. Ward. Morning, Howie.
Morning, Joe.
Children, Wally, Emily, time to get up.
Mom, I'm here. Mama, how young Mama looks. Never knew Mama was ever that young. Thank you. gone by, I'm dead. Your grandmother, Mama, I married George Gibbs. Wally's dead, too. His appendix burst on a camera trip to Crawford Notch. We felt just terrible about it, don't you remember? Mama, just for a moment, we're happy. Mama, just for a moment, we're together. Let's look at one another. Chew your bacon, go and slow.
It'll keep you warm on a cold morning.
Mama, what's this in the yellow paper?
That in the yellow paper is from your grandmother. I thought you'd like it, and you're old enough to have it now.
And this is from you. Why, it's beautiful, Mama, and it's just what I wanted.
I'm glad you like it. Your Aunt Carrie couldn't find one in Concord, so I had to send all the way to Boston for one.
Wally has something for you, too. He made it in annual training class. He's mighty proud of it, so make sure you make a big fuss about it. Your father has something for you, too. Don't know quite what it is. Here he comes.
Where's my girl? Where's my birthday girl?
I can't. I can't, boy. It goes so fast, we don't even have time to look at one another. All that was going on, and I never realized.
Back to
my grave. First, one more look. Right now. Bye. Bye, Grover's Corners. Mama. Papa. Goodbye to clocks ticking. My butternut tree. Oh, Mama, sunflowers. Food. Coffee. New iron dresses and hot baths. Sleeping. Waking up. Oh, Earth. You're too wonderful for anybody to realize you.
Trampling on the feelings of those about you. To spend and waste time as though you had a million years. To be always at the mercy of one self-centered passion or another. Yes, now you know. That's the happy existence in order to look back to. Ignorance and blindness.
Oh, that ain't the whole truth, and you know it, Simon Stimson. Look, it's clearing up. The stars are coming out. I don't know what its name is.
in the livery stable with somebody staying up late to talk. It's clearing up. There are the stars doing their old crisscross in the sky. The scholars haven't settled the matter yet. They seem to think there are no living beings up there, just chalk or fire. Only this one straining away to make something of itself. Strain so great every 16 hours everybody lies down to get a rest. 11 o'clock in Grover's Corners. Everybody's rested in Grover's Corners. Tomorrow's gonna be another day. You go home and get a good rest too. Good night.
Thank you. up in there.
Cat, you scared me.
It never hurts anybody. It's just a little egg to get some exercise.
Yeah.
Well, I guess so.
That's what I thought.
Well, you promise not to go eat anybody else?
You promise you'll never sit on me again?
Okay.
All right, I promise.
So the boy stopped sitting on his anger and wasn't ever relieved. He could have fun again without having to sit down all the time. Every once in a while, his anger would come out and do the things that he was.
I don't like it when you do that. Don't do it anymore.
But the anger
goes.
Oh. We have to stop now.
Oh, but it's so sad. Oh. We can make magic again, whatever we want. But they can't.
Oh. Yeah, they can. They can whenever they want to, Gus.
If they wish the magic spell with us, then they can be magic too, and they can get them again.
Yeah! Yeah. Okay, do you guys want to wish the magic spell with us?
Yeah!
I'm gonna go back, okay.